गुड इवनिंग मैम। मैम
वेरी गुड इवनिंग।
गुड इवनिंग मैम।
गुड इवनिंग परिमिता। गुड इवनिंग।
गुड इवनिंग मैम।
गुड इवनिंग।
गुड इवनिंग अनिता मैम।
वेरी गुड इवनिंग। हेलो। Good evening, one and all present here. At the outset, I wish you all a very happy Ganesh Chaturthi, and may Lord Ganesha bless us all. आप सब लोगों ने आज खूब सारी मिठाई बनाई होगी, and you must have offered that to Ganesha and celebrated the day with joy. So let God, Lord Ganesha, bless us all. Principal ma'am would be joining us very soon. And she has asked us to start with the webinar. So I'm going to present my screen myself only. I did not require any technical help. So please forgive me if there is any technical fall, and I would request you to bear with me. I request everybody to please mute your mics. I would be keeping the entire webinar very, very interactive, because I don't want to be a mere talker and speaker for this webinar. You can all see a slide on your screen, and it says a famous saying by Albert Einstein: education is not the learning of facts, but the training of the mind to think. Can anybody tell me the meaning of this thought? If we make it interactive, you will enjoy the webinar. Otherwise, I will be speaking and you would be listening.
Ma'am, may I initiate, ma'am?
Yeah, please, sir, please.
जी,
Ma'am, Swami Vivekananda has also said something like that only, ki we are not supposed to stuff the mind with facts and figures. Rather, mind is required to be groomed in such a way that people start thinking of their own and people start seeing different things in the same thing in a different way. So I believe that if we start believing in this, so we can definitely achieve wonders. So far as human mind is concerned, there is a lot which is there in human mind and that is required to be explored. And that can be done if we conduct such exercises which stimulate human mind to think.
Very true. Thank you so much, Mr. Rajiv. Wonderfully said that our education system is doing the reverse, I think. But CBSE has started a great initiative. And in this direction, this webinar has been conducted. This webinar is about Cogito and the question book. This is a series on thinking and problem solving skills, which has been introduced by CBSE of late. And these two books are wonderful books. These are comic books, which should be read by each one of you and should be, you know, all the children should be encouraged to read these two books, and they have been written for children only in a comic way for a joyful learning. The board has dedicated this academic session 2020-21 for competency-based learning. In the previous webinars, much has been talked about competency-based learning. Can anyone tell me what is competency-based learning? Anyone? We all.
Good evening, ma'am.
Yeah, good evening.
Ma'am, competency-based learning basically stands for the acquirement of skill sets, which is required for the 21st century. Overall development, 360-degree development of a child, which includes life skills, soft skills, as well as, you know, critical and creative thinking skills as well.
Very true, Swati. Thank you so much. So board has now started working in this direction so that we have the ability to develop critical and creative thinking skills, problem solving skills, collaboration and communication skills, and we can impart these skills to our children through various activities, through various projects and many more things which the children should be exposed to. And these skills are very crucial for the successful living in the 21st century. So these are the comic books which will also be a good resource to our students for PISA 2022. In the last two webinars, PISA was covered in a detailed amount. And can anyone tell me what is PISA? P-I-S-A? Anybody?
Program for International Student Assessment.
Thank you so much, ma'am, because I thought the primary teachers were not there in the previous webinars. Yes. So I must ask them what is PISA for a quick revision. Thank you so much, ma'am. Now, when we talk about these 21st century skills, why are they so important? They are so very important because they will be a lifelong learning. And we all face lots of problems in our daily life. We need to think critically at times, and for that, these skills are very important, and we must, you know, start working in this direction to develop these skills in our children. When I started working on this presentation, so I was intrigued by the word cogito. I thought it's a Japanese word, but to my surprise, this cogito is a Latin word which has been taken from a phrase, cogito ergo sum. Cogito means thinking, basically. And the meaning of this Latin phrase is, I think, therefore I am. Main sochta hun, isiliye mera astitv hai. So we the human beings have the capability to think, which keeps us apart from other animals, from plants, and from other non-living organisms. So we are superior because we are able to think, and therefore we are. This phrase was given by René Descartes, who was a French philosopher, mathematician and scientist. And I would like to share one more fact with you all that when I was preparing for this presentation and I was working on this cogito ergo sum, this is a very important philosophy when it comes to the preparation of preparation for UPSC exams. So jo IAS ke taiyari kar rahe hain, young teachers and others also, this is very important fact, and this finds a very important place in the world of philosophy. I have a question for you all. Does everyone think equally intelligently? Yes or no?
No,
ma'am. I would request to be participative because I will not be able to see the chat because I am presenting my screen. So I please request everybody, please unmute your mics and speak.
No, ma'am.
Equally, yes, it can be, but intelligently for everybody who's thinking, they would think that yes, I'm thinking it intelligently. So equally, it may not be possible, but for everybody intelligently, probably they might think.
Yeah, that's very true. That some people would say yes and some would say no, but we need to justify whatever we say. If I say yes, I need to justify. If I say I need to justify, this is what we need to teach our children. Otherwise, they will be only yes sirs and yes ma'ams. Well, a well-trained mind can definitely think better. So hame kya karna hai? We need to train our children more intelligently, logically, analytically, and critically. And how can we do that? We can do that by training their mind at a very early age itself, and we can expose them to various activities, projects, you know, class proceedings, and we can, you know, teach them to question, which we discourage always. So that's my request to all of you, that if we start training the mind of the children at a very early stage, we would be able to intelligent and logically thinking, analytically, you know, analytical and critically thinking people in future. This is a very small riddle which you can ask a child of a pre-nursery itself. Just have a look at this riddle. This has been taken from Cogito series only. If all of these statements are true, where is the gold? Just have a look at the slide on your screen. The gold is not in two. The gold is in one or three. The gold is not in here.
One.
You all are very right. Thank you so much. The chest number one has the gold. Now, for a small child, how would you explain him and how would you help him to solve this problem?
So, ma'am, we break down the problem.
Yeah,
sorry.
Yeah, the very first step is we need to break down the problem and we need to see the statements which are written here. The next slide is the analysis of this problem. If statement one is true, then gold cannot be in chest two. You all know that because you all are thinking critically, but for a small kid, you need to expose him to this kind of riddle, these kind of riddles, and analyze them in the class, then only we can develop critically thinking minds. Similarly, if the statement two is right, the gold cannot be in chest three. Hence, the gold must be in chest one. So what we are doing here, first of all, the problem was broken into different statements and different statements were seen, they were read and they were analyzed. And if all these statements are true, then the answer is that the gold is in chest one. So such kind of riddles should be discussed in class and children should be asked to analyze. And if they are stating wrong answers, you should be happy because they are using their mind and they are not coming to a conclusion that chest number one is the correct answer. So we must we should not discourage them if they are wrong. let us all see a video, and this video is also from TED Ed video, which is a riddle. Please lend your ears.
Excuse me, ma'am, I can't hear anything.
You have to pin
me not for the good.
Amita, the sound is missing.
Pardon?
The sound is missing.
Okay, I will play it once again. I told you initially, because I am presenting it myself, so there may be technical glitches. Give me a second, I will present it again. हेलो अच्छा ठीक है मैं इसको डायरेक्टली चलाती हूँ इसी के साथ साथ अच्छा ठीक है ठीक ओके ओके
ma'am, excuse me, it is okay, still not audible.
Okay.
Amita ma'am, excuse me.
See, I would be showing you this video at the end, and I think it's not working. I tried twice. So we would be discussing this at the end, and I would directly take it from YouTube instead of this presentation. I would be presenting my screen there. So in the meanwhile, let us discuss the problem number one. Just have a look at this problem on the screen. Rajesh is cooking a meal for some friends. This will involve roasting corns, which will take 2 hours. Cooking time plus 15 minutes resting on removal from the oven. The oven takes 15 minutes to warm up. He will also cook some rice, 30 minutes soaking plus 15 minutes cooking. Cabbage, 5 minutes to prepare and 5 minutes to cook. And tomato sauce, 10 minutes to prepare and 15 minutes to cook. What should be the timing of each step of cooking the meal if the friends are to eat at 7 p.m.? Can anyone try the answer? When should Rajesh start cooking so that the friends can eat the dinner at 7 p.m.? And what is the strategy to solve such problems? You may try your answers. The question is, when should Rajesh start cooking the meal if the friends are to eat at 7 p.m.? Yeah, please.
May I try, ma'am? Ma'am, I would say he should start 2.5 hours before, that is at around 4:30. Because the maximum time called is for the corn, and while the corn is cooking, he can finish off all the other work. Meanwhile, he can prepare the cabbage.
So he should start at 4:30. Yeah.
4:30.
So how did you conclude this, Manisha?
Because like I just saw that the maximum time required is for the corn. That is 2 hours cooking and 15 minutes for the oven to heat up and 15 minutes later on. So that makes it 2.5 hours. And the rest of the preparation is not much, like the cooking of the rest of the stuff. So he can simultaneously do the rest of the job.
Yeah. Excellent, Manisha. You got it right.
Thank you, ma'am.
He should start cooking at 4:30 p.m. And how can we ask the children to solve such problems? They should make a table initially, and they should write all the steps of cooking in a table, and they should start backwards. And if they do in this, if they work like this, the timings would be 4:30. He should start cooking at 4:30, and the table is to be made, and the child should start writing everything backwards. So Manisha got it right, and I was expecting answers from maths or science departments. Thank you, Manisha.
Thank you, ma'am. So the
child should make a table and write all these steps in backward direction, and that is how we should be able, we will be able to solve such problems. There's another problem on the screen. 55 kilograms of paper is used by a person per year. That means 10,000 sheets. If we stack the A4 sheets used in a single year on top of each other, what would be the height of the stack? This is for a child of class 6th or 7th. Even class 5 child can also solve it. Can you try your hands on it? If we stack the A4 sheets used in a single year on top of each other, what would be height of the stack? Qutub Minar, Statue of Unity, distance to the moon, or distance to the sun?
And it's distance to the moon.
Distance to the moon, right?
Yes, ma'am, it's distance to the moon.
Distance to the moon is the correct answer. And the analysis is, if you find out the height of one sheet, then that comes to be 0.1 mm. How? If you see the ream, that is, the height of that ream is 5 centimeter. and the total number of pages are 500. So that comes to 0.1 mm. And you, if you multiply this 10,000 pages with 0.1, it comes to 1 meter. And the world population is 7 billion. So it comes to 0.700000 kilometers. And that is the distance to the moon is 4 lakh kilometers. So we can go 18 times to the moon when we stack the 70,000 sheets here on top of each other. 10,000 sheets multiplied by the number of population of the world. So this kind of problem, these kinds of problem, they require a lot of thinking, lot of analysis, but they require a lot of practice. So if we expose our children to such kind of problems, they would definitely, their minds would definitely be trained, because here in this question, he should know the height of one sheet, and for that he should know what is ream. The stack he should know, that comes in market. He should know that the ream contains 500 pages, and then the data is that 10,000 sheets are used by one person, multiplied by that 1 meter. The child should also know what is the world population. He should be able to convert meter into kilometers and vice versa. And that way, he should be asked to solve such problems. And these problems are great to develop critical thinking skills. This is a slide which I have taken from Cogito only. And this requires special mention because it's a problem solving framework given by George Polya. He was a Hungarian mathematician and he made fundamental contributions to number theory, numerical analysis, and probability theory. Now, the very first step to solve the problem is we must understand the problem first. Then we should find the connection between data and the unknown. We should carry out the plan and then examine the solution which is obtained. So if we follow these four steps, then definitely we would be able to solve any problem. And the previous problem was based on these steps only. There is a Ludo board on your screen. Can you tell me who has more chances to win? Red one or yellow one?
Ma'am, equal chances.
Equal chances.
Yes, equal.
What equal is chances. The, how did you conclude that?
Ma'am, in a Ludo die, the probability of getting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 is equal. The probability of getting each number is equal, ma'am.
So the probability is 1/6 in both cases, and that is the reason that both of them have the equal chances of winning. So such kind of questions, if we discuss in class, they would definitely benefit children. There's another strategy which has been given by Polya. And he says that if we guess and test, and if it satisfies the demands of the problem, then definitely we will find a solution. And the question here is, Mr. Jones has a total of 25 chickens and cows on his farm. Please read it carefully. Mr. Jones has a total of 25 chickens and cows on his farm. How many of each does he have if all together there are 76 feet? In total, he has 25 chickens and cows together. On
ma'am, 29.
Okay. Shall I hear from others? See how to solve this problem. We are given in the problem that there are 25 chickens and cows, and altogether there are 76 feet. And we all know that chickens have 2 feet and cows have 4 feet. This is the first step that we need to understand the problem. Yes?
Ma'am, 12 chickens and 13 cows.
Okay, maybe. Let's see. Then second step is devise a plan. We have to use guess and test method. And for that, we need to make a table and see the pattern. See, these are 20 chickens, 5 cows, and the total number of feet 60. 21, 4, number of chicken feet 42, cow feet 16, the total number of feet 58. Now, if you start guessing, you will see that if we increase the number 21 and to 4 here, and we decrease it here, it has become 58. So we are going in the wrong direction. So the step 3 is we have to carry out the plan, and the total number of feet is decreasing. So it's better that we increase the number of feet in this case. So this is how we can guess and we can come to a conclusion. And the correct answer is, what is the correct answer here?
Which one? 12 plus 13.
Yes, 12 plus 13. So Prabhat, you were right that there are 12 chickens and 13 cows in his on his farm, and that comes to 52 and so on. This is my favorite question, which I usually ask in all the classes. And believe me not, even a class 12th child is not able to answer. So let me try my hands in this webinar. Are bacteria plants or animals?
Ma'am, although I'm not from this background, but I think it should be animal because they do not make their own food, I think.
Amita ma'am, I think it's animals.
Animals. You have to give the reason also.
Because they don't make their own food. They have to
all
depend.
Right. Anybody else?
Yes, ma'am. What I have classified as plants because they are cell walls. Like okay. If you go into cell wall and cell membrane, yeah.
Okay, Indula. Anyone else?
Ma'am, it is neither plant nor animal.
Okay.
Neither animals nor plants.
All right. So we get, if you ask this question in class, you will get variety of answers. Some would say bacteria, plants, but I always encourage the students that whatever they say, they are able to justify that. If they say bacteria are plants, they are very right because they are justifying it right. As Indula said, bacteria, they have cell wall. And we have been teaching them that the cell which has got cell wall, so that's a plant cell. So I never tell them ki you are wrong because they are able to justify. Why are they animals? They are animals because they are unable to make their food. So they are just like animals. They are depending on others for making up for food. They are not autotrophic. They are not able to make their own food. So my sincere request to all of you is please ask questions in the class, and they should also be asking questions from you, and don't discourage them from asking questions. And whatever answer they give, they should be able to justify. So we need to train their mind that they are able to justify their answers. This question does not have a correct answer. There are multiple answers if you give right justification. For me, it's a plant because it has a cell wall. For others, it's an animal because it's not able, bacteria are not able to make their own food. And for some others, for a class 12 child or for a scientist, then they are neither plants nor animals because they share a different set of characters which are not similar to plants or animals. So, posing this question in front of you, my only, aim was to encourage the children that they should ask question, and whatever answer they speak, they should be able to justify their answer. Never ever discourage them that you are wrong, tumko kuch nahi aata, baith jao tum. He should be able to justify the answer, maybe it's wrong. There is another question here on the screen. Vaccination is one of the most effective ways to prevent disease. Pulse polio is an immunization campaign established by the Indian government to eliminate polio in India by vaccinating all children under the age of 5 years against the polio virus. However, polio drops are not given to children suffering from diarrhea. Any answers for this? We all see, we have pulse polio program going on. लेकिन जब वो देने आते हैं पल्स पोलियो घर में, then they ask कि आपके बच्चे को डायरिया तो नहीं है, then they don't give. We all teach vaccination in class 6, 7th, 8th and in senior classes also, but we never pose such questions to our children.
It's an oral vaccine, ma'am. Ma'am, it's an oral vaccine. Polio vaccine is an oral vaccine.
Yeah.
It can be excreted out through the motion, that's why.
Yeah, very true, Umesh sir. I was expecting either Umesh sir or Vidhi ma'am who should be able to answer. And I was right. The correct answer is that if the child is suffering from diarrhea and this is a oral vaccine, so the child would pass it out through motion. So it will be of no use. So such kind of questions we should discuss in the class. I have another question which I generally ask in class, that when we teach hormones, and there we talk about that insulin hormone is secreted by pancreas, and deficiency of insulin leads to diabetes. And we all see a lot of diabetic people around. But we have also seen that when the insulin is given to the patient, a diabetic patient, we always give an injection to the person. We never give it orally. Can you give me the reason for that? Can you try the answer? We all have some or the other diabetic person around. Lekin insulin hamesha injection ki form mein diya jata hai.
I think, ma'am, it is more effective in when we given in injection form, because it mixes well very fast in the blood and to maintain the blood sugar in our.
Amita ma'am.
Because insulin needs to go into bloodstream rather than to go into the digestive tract. So orally it will be of no use. So it should go into the bloodstream. So it's given.
Secrete in the bloodstream.
It will take very long to get into the bloodstream if it is given orally.
Ma'am, actually, insulin is digestible. That's why it's not given on.
It is broken down by digestion.
It is digestible.
Yes, you all are right. You got it right. This is very true that insulin, first of all, if it is given in the form of injection, it will directly go into blood and it is more effective and the sugar level will go down immediately. But the most important reason that is not given orally, it is always given through injection, is insulin is a protein. And if you take it orally, then it's going to be digested through the enzymes. So it will be of no use. So this is very important thing which you must teach the children, that if they should be able to question. Humne simple bata diya unko ki there's a diabetic patient and he's given insulin. That's all. He learns, he vomits it out, but he's never able to learn other skills, that is critical thinking skills. So we must pose such questions in the class. And you all got it right. It will be digested because it's a protein if it is taken orally. Agar isko hum tablet ki form mein lenge, so ye digest ho jayegi and it will not be useful at all. This is an activity which was done by class 11th and 12th students, and most of you have been teaching germination in class 5-4 in primary classes. And what we asked them that beta ghar mein seeds aap please germinate kar lena, and then you will see radical, you will see plumule, you will see cotyledons. Jo hum sprouts khate hain, they are all radicals, and agar usme leaf bhi aa jaye, they are plumules. This is for the information of non bio teachers. The sprout is actually the root radical, future root, and the plumule is the future shoot, that is stem and leaf. So hum bachcho ko kya bolte hain, we ask them that you grow that and do it, but we never teach them how to analyze it critically. So what we can do, instead of asking them to simply grow the seeds and watch them, they can do it, but when we can move one step ahead, we can ask each student to germinate two or three types of seeds and make observations. So if we have 20 children in the class, we can ask them to have different kinds of seeds and they can germinate these seeds differently and make observations. Whatever they find, they should come in the class. They should critically analyze it. They should share with the peers. This is definitely going to promote collaborative learning, and it will also develop scientific temperament. Now, what are the findings? How is it developing the critical thinking skill? The child can be asked to draw a graph and see the growth. You can see in this graph, moong dal took very less time to germinate. Black gram took more time. Kidney bean, that is rajma, took more time. And chickpea also took a lot of time. That chickpea is chana, safed chana, jo hum kabuli chana khate hain. So this kind of graph, if we ask them to draw, we can collaborate. We can collaborate this activity with maths also, and they would be thinking critically. And I must share one example here. When I asked my children to do it, I was not aware that organic seeds, they don't germinate easily. So sometimes students can be very good teachers. Till date, I did not know, because some of the children, what they did, they took organic seeds. And when they brought the observations in the class, we found that organic seeds, they took comparatively more time to germinate. So by observing such kind of activities, we can develop critical thinking skills in our children. Or simply by saying ki germinate kar lena, you will see a radical. That's okay. That is the first step. But we can go one step ahead by asking them this kind of activity. This is the actual activity which was done. Kidney bean, chickpeas, black gram, and moong beans. And you can see, this is the picture after first day. You can see the moong beans. Aap log ghar mein bhi dekhte honge. Moong beans, they sprout very easily as compared to chana, white chana, black chana, and rajma. And now you can try your hands on organic seeds as well. This particular slide is especially for primary wing. How can we develop critical thinking skills? We have been giving them lots of practice sheets. I know that the society, the Child Education Society, is also working in that direction. And we all have been making lots of critical thinking worksheets. And we have been practicing and we are doing our bit. But I have compiled these five activities, and these are very small activities, and you can try your hands in class with the children. The first activity is question of the day. When you end your day in school, just write a question on the board. It should be a critical thinking question that can elicit reasons from your children. Children should be able to reason out, not any question. Give them a specified amount of time to think about the answer. Maybe you can ask them, aap ghar se soch kar aana, we'll discuss it out. You can give this question in the morning itself, and you can ask them, at the end of the day, we are going to discuss in the last period, what are the answers? Ask them to write their answers on a piece of paper. Once done, they may put them in the response box, draw answers from the box and read them aloud. Discuss the answer among your children. You will be happy to see that children have all varieties of questions and they all have their justifications. You cannot say, beta, tumhara answer galat hai and tumhara answer galat hai. This kind of activity encourages thorough analysis of situations based on information present to your kids' surroundings. If a child is living with his or her grandparents, he would have a different answer. If a child is living in a nuclear family, he would have a different answer. So based on their immediate surroundings, you will have different kind of answers, and you will come to know that what kind of critical thinking your child A or child B has in your class. You'll be able to know them better. The second activity is make your menu. And I think pre-primary children are doing this activity. And what we can do is that we can give them some ingredients and we can ask them to come up with their own menu from the said ingredients and let them name five meals so that they will think deeply about the food they eat every day. And again, if you try this activity, no two activities or no two children would be same, because their thinking level is different, their observation skills are different, their critical thinking skills are different. So I would not take much on these activities, because I would like you to try these activities in your classes. Now, what is the aim of this activity? This activity develops creativity among children by allowing them to mix and match ingredients together. So here you will come to know who is more creative in your class. Third activity is the fact or opinion. What is the difference between fact and opinion? Can anyone tell me? It's very simple.
Ma'am, fact is fact. It cannot be changed from person to person. Opinion, a different person may have a different opinion.
Yeah. So these young, very, very true, Prabhat. Young should be asked to differentiate between facts and opinions. And for that, we can give them some statements. I've written some statements for you. Smoking is bad for health. Dogs make better pets than cats. My toy is the best toy in the world. You are shorter than me, though this statement should not be encouraged. Ask them to explain why a certain statement is a fact and why another is an opinion. That is the first step. They should be asked ki isme se kaun sa fact hai aur kaun sa opinion hai. So you can frame n number of statements and you can discuss this activity in class, because this activity will foster open-mindedness as it lets your children differentiate facts from mere opinions. So that's another activity which we can do not only in primary but in middle school as well. Fourth activity is take a side. You all would agree with me that communication is very vital critical thinking skill that your children must develop, and sharing ideas with a group of critical thinkers allows you to figure out solutions to complex problems. That's why communication is crucial. Your children can develop this skill with the take a side activity. What we can do, we can have two opposite views, and we can have children agreeing to the first view coming to one side and the other group of children coming to the other side. Now, children would definitely enjoy this activity, though during online classes we cannot do it, but definitely when we have offline classes, then this activity can be done. Now, what is the importance of such activity? Ask children who agree to stand on one side of the room, ask the others who disagree take the other side of the room. Let them discuss why they agree or disagree on the topic. They should be able to answer ki wo agree kyon kar rahe hain aur agree kyon nahi kar rahe hain. So that is how you will be able to develop communication skills in them. And the best part is you can allow the kids to switch sides if they change their mind during the debate. If the debate is happening in class, you will see definitely there are some children who would change their sides. And this activity will enhance communication as it allows your children to speak out and exchange reasons with one another. Last activity is build a geometric house. And this is a very simple activity. The children can be asked to make triangles from anything. They can take sticks, they can take any other material which is at home, and they can be asked to draw or design a house. You will see that they will make 2D houses, they will make 3D houses, but the only condition is that they should be using only triangles. So such kind of activities will definitely teach them problem solving skills, as they have to figure out where they should put the triangles to build a house. So these are quite a few activities, but these are not the exhaustive, a number of activities you can think of. And the last slide of today's webinar is, people need to develop critical thinking skills at an early age for them to grow up capable of making reasoned judgments. With reasoned judgments, they will be able to make informed decisions which they need to survive, and more importantly, make the world a better place. It's your duty as a teacher to teach this vital skill to your children. You can start from these activities and raise a critical thinker that can make the significant change this world needs. I would like to draw your attention to this notification from CBSE and one or two problems which I discussed in today's webinar. I took it from this particular webinar, and please encourage all the students of your class to watch this on YouTube channel. You can note down, this is the notification from CBSE and the name of the webinar is 3030 STEM. And it happens every Sunday between 4 to 5 p.m. And the program fee is 100 for teachers for 30 weeks, but children can watch it on YouTube. And believe me not, this is a wonderful webinar series. And I have attended only one, and the second is due for tomorrow. I request all of you to please watch this series every week on Sunday between 4 to 5. And you should share this with children as well. And it doesn't cost anything to children. It is free for them. Students and parents, but there are no certificates for them. So you can share this information with your students. These are quite a few links which I have compiled. This is the same. This is IIT Gandhinagar, the third one, which is this IIT Gandhinagar is conducting 3030 STEM webinar, which is a series of 30 webinars every Sunday. Then Diksha portal, you all are aware, you have been using it also. You can reach out to ICER Pune site also for all the science activities. And last is the TED-Ed video, which due to some technical glitch could not run today. I would request all of you to please see it. And this has been recommended by CBSE also, TED-Ed puzzles. TED-Ed puzzles are very important and they are crucial for developing critical thinking skills in our children. And last, there's a point to ponder for all of us. If we teach today's students as we taught yesterday's, we rob them of tomorrow, by John Dewey. Please ponder over this point and be a critical thinker and teach your students critically and let them be problem solvers of tomorrow. If anyone has any question, they may ask.
Madam, actually, there's no question in the mind because everything has been explained so nicely. The only thing I want to say is that it seems as if this 60-minute session got over in 15 minutes because it was so engrossing, so interactive, and so nicely prepared, and everything was so nicely organized. Madam, I must thank you, and I must thank our secretary, Madam Asha, Madam, for the kind of arrangements which have been made for our education. Our perspective on education has changed ever since we have been watching all these webinars. I mean, we have come to know the significance of research-based education. I mean, so much of research is being done at your end. Everybody is so deep into research. It is really, ma'am, not only educative, it is truly inspiring. And this I am saying from the bottom of my heart. Wonderful job, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. And lastly, I would like to propose the vote of thanks. And I would like to thank Principal Ma'am for giving me this opportunity, which not only broadened my vision, but also helped me to grow as a learner. My heartfelt thanks to the principals of sister schools for their precious time. My sincere gratitude to Vice Principal Ma'am for her guidance and support. I'm immensely thankful to all the teachers of my sister units and my fellow colleagues for patient listening. Thank you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Satan.
थैंक यू सो मच मैम.
अंजलि आप भी आ गए.
थैंक यू मैम.
थैंक यू सो मच मैम. थैंक यू मैम.
अमिता मैम थैंक यू.
पल्लवी सर आपको क्या समझ आया आप ये बताइए मुझे. एक चीज बताइए.
समझ में नहीं आया लेकिन अच्छा लगा बहुत.
नहीं सर आप मुझे बताइए.